Hello everyone, I just wanted to give you a quick update on the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam. Now, I do hear some rumors sometimes that things have changed. Students are a little bit worried because they heard that the exam had changed a bit and maybe the questions have got harder. So I like to check and just make sure that that nothing major has changed and look out for what the changes are, if there are any, so that I can make sure I update my courses accordingly. Now, I took the CCP exam again. Of course, I can't tell you exactly what I found because that would be against the rules of the exam. But what I can do is just talk to you about a few tips about the types of services and the types of things that you might get asked so that you can make sure that you're studying appropriately. So what I'll do now is take you over to a blog article and just go through with you some tips for studying for the CCP exam to make sure that you're going to get through your exam comfortably. I'm on a blog article here, and if I just scroll down a bit, what I got is just a few of the top study tips. Now, of course, these are not the only things you need to learn. These are just some of the topics which are coming up quite a lot, and not just on exams that I've seen myself, but also we've got lots of feedback from students. We have thousands of students on Cloud Practitioner courses, and so we regularly get feedback on what they're seeing in the exam. So these are just a few of the things which I just want to emphasize. Make sure you got these in your training because these are definitely coming up quite a lot. So starting on the first one here, AWS Organizations. So you should know about organizations. You don't need to know it in a very deep detail. Just understand about how you can implement consolidated billing with AWS Organizations. And service control policies is something that comes up. These are used for controlling the API actions that are available in the member accounts in an organization. So you just need to know at a very basic level what you use the SCPs for. You don't need to know how to write them. They won't go into very much detail in terms of allow lists and deny lists and the complexities that you might see if you're doing an associate level certification. You just need to know what they're for. AWS Global Accelerator is something that's relatively new, and it's relatively new in terms of featuring on the exam as well. And it doesn't come up much, but you might see a couple of questions and you need to understand what it is. It's actually a networking service. It enables you to run things like EC2 and application load balancers and network load balancers in different regions and then have a couple of IP addresses on the internet which you can access them through. And it uses the global network. It uses AWS's global network. So that means it provides some performance characteristics, some performance improvements. It improves latency. And it provides failover. Now, you don't need to know much more about that, but I suggest you look into our courses, look into our cheat sheets, read up on Global Accelerator, understand at a basic level what it is and what it does, and what the benefits are, of course, and that's about it for the Cloud Practitioner exam. Amazon Elastic MapReduce is a hosted Hadoop framework, so it's used for analytics purposes, and you don't need to know much more about it than that. You really just need to understand if a question is asking for a hosted Hadoop framework, then that's going to be EMR. Now, Trusted Advisor does come up lots. You know, you might get several questions on Trusted Advisor, so make sure you understand this service. It actually provides guidance and best practices on several different areas, such as security best practices. It gives you optimization for your performance. It can identify security groups that are being used that might be too open, that kind of thing. So there's quite a few things there. I'm not going to give you all the details now. Just go up and make sure that you're reading up on Trusted Advisor or going through the course videos for Trusted Advisor, and you'll be well set. So just make sure you've got that one covered because you will see a few questions. Next up, we've got AWS Cloud Benefits. This is massive for the exam. So AWS really want you to understand what the benefits of the cloud are. Think about the 6 advantages of cloud. There's a good article linked there that you can look at. And you've really got to understand these. Things like agility and scalability. You have to understand why would a customer who is currently in an on-premises environment move into AWS? What would be the advantages? Things like billing as well, you know, having a pay-as-you-go pricing, that comes up quite a lot on the exam, as does having an operational cost versus paying out on a capital cost. So make sure you understand the cloud benefits. For cost management tools, there's a few tools such as AWS Budgets and AWS Cost Explorer that you need to understand. Using cost allocation tags is another thing that can occasionally pop up, as well as consolidated billing with organizations. The next one on the list here is Quick Starts. AWS Quick Starts are essentially cloud formation templates that have been pre-created for you to actually deploy common applications, so common application configurations. If you go and have a look on the Quick Starts page, let's just open this one up, you'll find several different Quick Starts. Well, there's lots of them, we've got 200 here. So you'll see lots of standard application packages which are created through a template, and you can just go and deploy these using CloudFormation. And it's just a few clicks to actually deploy these applications on AWS. So Quick Starts can come up, and the typical use case is when you want to deploy some kind of standard application on AWS very easily. So it's about reducing operational overhead and the expertise you need to set it up. Next up, RDS. This is a mainstay for the cloud practitioner. They're always asking questions on Amazon RDS, the relational database service. Make sure you understand what you're responsible for as a customer with RDS and what AWS will manage. It is a managed service, but there are some responsibilities for the customer as well. For instance, you need to specify your maintenance windows. There are some that are predefined for you, but you have some control in setting up your maintenance windows at times that suit you. So just understand what's included in a maintenance window and what RDS or AWS are actually going to manage for you for your RDS databases. Next up here, I have IAM policies. So IAM policies are a way that you can apply permissions to users, groups, roles, and also to resources. So you don't have to go into much detail on the cloud practitioner, which is the good news. You don't need to write policies. You certainly don't need to read them either. And all you need to know is the basics about what they're used for, how they can be attached. So for example, applying a policy to a group, putting a user in a group, and then the user will then get the permissions assigned to the policy. And that's a standard best practice. So that's something that can often come up. Also, there are managed policies. Managed policies are ones that are pre-created by AWS. You can't modify them. They're very useful for things like typical job roles or just typical use cases. Now, you can create your own. So if they don't work for you and you have to customize them, you can't customize the managed policies. You just create your own policy, and that's called a custom policy. VPC flow logs is something that comes up. VPC flow logs capture network data. So this is about being able to understand what's happening on the network, what the traffic flows are. You need to understand this at a basic level. You basically just need to know when you would use VPC flow logs versus CloudTrail versus S3 server access logging versus ELB access logs. All of that's in the course. All of that's very easy to find out as well just by doing a search on the AWS website. AWS WAF is a web application firewall. This comes up quite often, so you just need to understand what it's used for. I actually saw this as an incorrect answer a few times. It was often just there, and if you don't know what it is, then you could get confused and wonder if that was the correct answer to the question. So just understand what it is, what it's used for. It's about protecting from web exploits by creating rules to protect your infrastructure on AWS, and specifically that it sits in front of CloudFront, application load balancers, API gateways, and AWS App Sync. Now, the shared responsibility model, this is a standard tip. You always have to know this for the cloud practitioner exam and for many other AWS exams as well, but it's particularly common as questions on the cloud practitioner. So make sure you understand the shared responsibility model. Snowball comes up quite a bit, including Snowball Edge more often these days. So understand how you migrate data when you would use Snowball Edge versus Direct Connect, or Snowball versus Direct Connect. If you have huge quantities of data, then Snowball is often a good way if you don't have good enough internet links or bandwidth to be able to support the migration, or it would just take too long. So just understand the different types of Snowball device, including Snowball Edge and Snowmobile as well. And then it's worth understanding AWS Database Migration Service, the server migration service, and data sync as well. I've seen the abuse team come up. I know other students have reported this as well. It's just about understanding when and what you would report to the AWS abuse team. So just look that up. Very simple. Wouldn't take you a few minutes just to understand the basics of what their purpose is. and then you'll be able to answer those questions easily. AWS Glue comes up occasionally. This is used for extract, transform, and load. You don't need to know too much more about it than that. Basically, it just means you're extracting data from a database, you're transforming it in some way, and then you're loading it into another database. Just understand Glue is for ETL, and that should do you fine. Then code commit. So the developer tools have always come up in the Cloud Practitioner exam. Some people are surprised by this, but they do. But they're generally really simple questions. You just need to understand the different developer tools. So that's code commit, code build, code deploy, and code pipeline. And just understand what they're for. I've seen code commit come up more often than the other ones. It's a version, a software version control system. So it's similar to Git. It's used for committing different versions of code. And it allows developers to then work on code collaboratively. Second from last here, we've got design principles. This is quite a big one as well. This comes up in quite a few questions. Make sure you understand the five pillars of the well-architected framework. You need to understand at a basic level what or how you architect applications on AWS. AWS want to make sure that, and this is very much related back to the advantages of the cloud. If you architect properly, you get to leverage the advantages of the cloud better. So they want to understand that you understand the basic design principles for how you build applications on AWS to best take advantage of the platform. And then we've got QuickSight. That came up for me in a question. Just understand the basics of QuickSight, what it's used for, and you'll be fine there. So that's it for my exam tips. The exam guide hasn't changed much. The core of the exam is pretty much the same as it was several months ago. There's always just a few slight changes. So as long as you just follow these tips and do the full courses to make sure you're across the core of the knowledge required, then you'll do just fine. So I hope that was useful and good luck for your exam.